If we look at B'nai Noach, the concept comes from the Torah itself. As I said at the beginning, all of the humanity descend from Noah. The rabbis understand from Bereshit chapter 9, when Noah comes out of the ark, the God makes a covenant with humanity, an eternal covenant, says Berit Olam, with all of humanity by way of Noah.
Berit Olam, normally it's translated, I guess, in our Bible as a covenant with the world. But I guess Olam can also mean eternal.
Eternal.
So it's an eternal covenant.
That's right. It's an eternal covenant. Mm-hmm. And a way to remember this eternal covenant is the rainbow, the Keshet. This reminds us of this covenant, which is eternal. We have two covenants that are working together, which are not contradicting each other. We have the covenant with Noah and all of humanity, and then we have the covenant at Sinai with the nation of Israel and all those who were there at that moment, and all those who will add themselves to this nation by conversion.
So the covenant at Sinai did not supersede the covenant with Noah?
No.
Still in effect.
Yes. Right. Definitely. In fact, if we look through the Tanakh, we will find various B'nai Noach who are assisting or who are interacting with the Israelites. For example, we look at Nebuchadnezzar, who is the king of Babylon. The scripture says in Sefer Daniel that he boasted and he was full of himself. And the Eternal One, blessed be He, humbled him for a period of 7 years. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't until he recognized that the king of heaven is the truthful king, that he was healed of his sickness, his mental sickness. We will ask ourselves, how did this happen and why did it happen? Nebuchadnezzar, being a non-Jew or non-Israelite, was under the covenant of the B'nai Noach. Mm-hmm. And one of the first precepts of the B'nai Noach is to worship one God. And many of these emperors and kings in these nations of this time period, they believed themselves to be God on earth, or the embodiment of divinity. This will be a contradiction or violation of that first principle. And we see various cases of B'nai Noach. We see also the captain of Nebuchadnezzar's army, Nebuzaradan, who helped the prophet Yirmiyahu come out of the pit. And many, many other cases we will find throughout the Tanakh of non-Jewish people who are keeping their covenant. We can even see in Sefer Bereshit, where Yosef, the son of Yaakov or Israel, when he goes to Mitzrayim and Potiphar's wife tries to take him, Yosef says he ran away because he didn't want to violate the principles that were given to him. We ask ourselves, what principle is this? Where did he learn that it was wrong to commit adultery, to take the wife of someone else? He learned it from the oral traditions that were handed down to him. He was not a Jew, because the concept of Jew comes after Sinai. He was a Ben Noach. He had the obligation to protect this mitzvah. Where do we learn of this mitzvah? We go back to chapter 2 of Bereshit, where it says, a man shall leave his father and his mother, and he shall cleave to his wife. So the rabbis learned his wife and not another man's wife. From here we learn that there is a concept of an oral tradition which is passed down from Adam to Noah, and then with Noah, a seventh precept was given, which was not to eat a limb from a live animal. And then these seven are passed down to the Hebrews and everyone who is descending from all these people, which probably today are found in Africa or in other Middle Eastern traditions.
Visit NoahideOnline.org to enroll today.